When Jolene and I came to church this morning, we came to the first service and we enjoyed the company of lots of people between the two services. We came to the second service and I thought, why did the bishop send us here? I think the bishop sent us here so that we would see family. I think the bishop sent us here because this is the place where retired pastors come. I think the bishop sent us here because this church knows how to love children. I think the bishop sent us here because we have amazing musicians and singers. And the music makes one's heart and soul soar. I think the bishop sent us here because he loved us. This is family. This is an amazing church. Church family, thank you. And now, hear the word of God according to the evangelist John, beginning with the 21st verse, or the 21st chapter, and the very first verse. After this, Jesus revealed himself again to the disciples by the Sea of Tiberias, and he revealed himself in this way: Simon Peter, Thomas, called the twin, Nathanael of Cana in Galilee, the sons of Zebedee, and two others of his disciples, they were together. Simon Peter said to them, I'm going fishing. That's my kind of disciple, isn't it? When things don't seem to be right, let's just go fishing. They said to him, we'll go with you. They went out and got into the boats, but that night they caught nothing. Just as day was breaking, Jesus stood on the beach. You know, I hate to keep pausing, but that's where I want to see Jesus, on the beach. Amen? So Jesus stood on the beach. Yet the disciples, they didn't know it was Jesus. And Jesus said to them, children, have you any fish? They answered him, no. He said to them, cast the net on the right side of the boat, and you'll find some. So they cast it. And now they were unable to haul it in for the quantity of the fish. That disciple whom Jesus loved said to Peter, it is the Lord. When Peter Simon heard that it was the Lord, he put on his clothes, for he was stripped for work, and sprang into the sea. But the other disciples came in the boat, dragging the net full of fish, for they were not far out from the land, but about 100 yards off. When they got out on land, they saw a charcoal fire there with fish lying on it and bread. And Jesus said to them, bring some of the fish that you have just caught. So Simon Peter went aboard and hauled the net ashore full of large fish, 153 of them. And although there were so many, the net was not torn. Jesus said to them, come and have breakfast. Now none of the disciples dared ask him, who are you? They knew it was the Lord. Jesus came and took the bread and gave it to them, and so with the fish. This was now the third time that Jesus was revealed to the disciples after he was raised from the dead. The word of God for all of us, the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Pastor?
Well, I appreciate Pastor Dale inviting me to preach today. And it's a privilege to bring a message from God's Word, especially during this Easter season. Let us pray. May the words of the risen Christ resound in our hearts as well as our ears as we come to listen and to obey His voice. Amen. Through the years, I have participated in many Easter sunrise services. And some were held on the lake, others were held on the river, and some at the beach overlooking the ocean. One of the memorable occasions, I preached at Delray Beach. And sitting in a chair beside the podium, because he was hard of hearing, he said, was the city's leading rabbi, Sam Silver. And I thought maybe he was going to make sure I didn't make any anti-Jewish statements, but when I was done, he said I had done well, which made me wonder what I left out about the resurrection story. I enjoyed them all, but perhaps the most memorable was when I got to stand on the overpass of what used to be the overpass at Jacksonville Beach and preach to over 3,000 persons gathered to welcome the new day and to celebrate the risen Lord. It seems as when you were elected president of the Ministerial Association, you got the privilege or the responsibility, whichever, of preaching on Easter. And so that was a joy. When we gather on the beach, we not only get a good view of the sunrise, but we also are reminded of Jesus who met with his disciples on the shore of Galilee. Now, the scripture Pastor Dale read sets the scene for today's message. Some of the disciples had gone fishing, and the Lord greeted them from the shore. He not only helps them bring in a haul of fish, but he also invited them to eat breakfast with him. Now, he serves them fish and bread, reminding us once again of the fellowship that we share in the breaking of bread, especially with our Lord, but also with each other. And it also brings to mind the little boy who brought his loaves and fishes to the Lord, who multiplied them. There were 12 basketfuls filled full of leftover fish and bread. Now, how about a show of hands? Have any of you ever gone fishing and used some of your catch for breakfast? All right, quite a few of you, that's good. And you must have had a sense of satisfaction and felt accomplished in being able to do that. On the other hand, how many of you hoped to catch your breakfast but didn't get a bite? All right, that happens too. Jesus took care of all that by telling them where to cast their net in order to pull in a heavy load of fish. Now, these men had shared many meals with Jesus, as well as seen him work miracles, from turning the water to wine, walking on the water, healing the sick, casting out devils, even raising the dead. Of course, Jesus himself was a miracle, having been conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin, and now raised from the dead. The passage I'm using opens where our reading left off at verse 15. And if you'd like to follow along, there's a little insert with the scripture and a few notes. You can either take that home or use it to follow along, whichever. When they were finished eating, Jesus said to Simon Peter, "Simon, son of John, do you truly love me more than these?" What a piercing question to ask of Peter. For as you may recall, it was Peter who swore that he would never betray his Lord and Master, and yet three times he had denied that he even knew him. Was Jesus testing Peter? Or was he seeking to confirm him in his faith and restore him to his place of leadership in the group? We can debate what Jesus meant by these. The most obvious would be, do you love me more than these fish? As in, are you going back to fishing instead of answering my call? He could have meant, do you love me more than these other disciples? In fact, they had all deserted Jesus in his hour of need. We could apply it to ourselves. Jesus asking us, do you love me more than the things of this world? Do you love me more than wealth, more than power, more than fame? You love me more than anything or anyone. Excuse me. There's a hymn whose opening verses say, Jesus calls us o'er the tumult of our life's wild, restless sea. Day by day, his sweet voice sounded, saying, Christian, follow me. Another verse says, Christian, love me more than these. And then the last verse ends, may you hear his call and give your heart to obedience, to service, and to love Christ best of all. Peter was one of the first persons that Christ called to follow him, and he told him, I will make you fishers of men. So where once he caught fish for a living, now he would capture the hearts of men for Christ. Is Jesus now giving Peter a chance to once again answer that call, this time in light of the crucifixion and the resurrection? As Pastor Dale pointed out in one of his messages, Peter was conflicted in that on the one hand, he had proclaimed Jesus as the Messiah, the Christ, the Son of the living God, but on the other hand, he had rebuked his Lord when Jesus said he was going to have to suffer and die. That was not what Peter had in mind for his master or for himself. Peter could be so beautiful in his devotion to Jesus, so impulsive in his responses to Jesus, and so emphatic in his denials of Jesus. Here he answers Jesus perhaps more thoughtfully than in past times as he says, yes, Lord, you know I love you. Which brings the question, does the Lord know we love him? And how does he know? Have we told him? Whether that be in worship, in praise, or in prayer. Have we shown him? Whether that be in personal devotion or through faithful service to others. Then Jesus said to Peter, feed my lambs. These three words are quite poignant. Jesus appears to be saying to Peter, if you love me, truly love me, then you will care for the flock. But he doesn't say sheep, he says lambs. Does that imply the little ones, like Logan Patrick, or the weak and vulnerable ones, or the new Christians, the babes in Christ? He certainly could. And how does he feed them? By sharing the teachings of Christ and the scriptures, but also it implies taking care of those who need help and protection, as well as spiritual food. I don't know if any of you have had the opportunity to see the movie Paul, the Apostle of Christ. It came out just in time for Holy Week. We got a behind-the-scenes glimpse into what it must have been like to live in Rome as the Christian, and what it was like to be a Christian in Rome during the time of Emperor Nero. The Christian community was led by Aquila and Priscilla, and they were seeking to minister to those in need by showing love and kindness and doing very practical things that needed to be done, as well as to encourage one another in the faith, in spite of the fact that their own lives were always in great danger. We remember Jesus' words, inasmuch as you've done it unto one of the least of these, you have done it unto me. We show our love in many ways, but one of them is by being the hands and feet of Jesus, and by embracing others on his behalf. We get to a certain stage in life, we like to look back and think of some of the things we were able to accomplish in the name of the Lord. But we don't do that very long before we think, now what am I doing for the Lord? What does he want me to do for him today, tomorrow, days ahead. We're at verse 16, where Jesus again said, "Simon, son of John, do you truly love me?" And he answered, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." And this time Jesus said, "Feed my sheep." A while back, Pastor Dale told us that Jesus is the good shepherd, a true protector and provider for the church. He said that we pastors are more like sheepdogs trying to keep the sheep together, while Jesus is the one who truly meets our needs. And yet we are sometimes called upon to sacrifice, even suffer, for others, just as Jesus suffered and died for us. We are fortunate to have Pastor Dale, because he radiates optimism, hope, and joy, and enthusiasm in all that he does. The third time Jesus said to him, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" And Peter was hurt because Jesus asked him the third time, "Do you love me?" He said, "Lord, you know all things. You know that I love you." And Jesus said, "Feed my sheep." It's interesting to note that when Jesus asked the question of Peter, he used a different Greek word for love. The first time, he used the word agape, a volitional, self-sacrificial love. More than a feeling, it's an act of will. And by saying more than these, he's asking Peter to compare his love with that of the others. The second time, Jesus focused on Peter alone. He used the word agape again. And the third time, Jesus uses the Greek word philia, signifying affection, affinity, or brotherly love. He was asking, in effect, "Are you even my friend?" Each time Peter answered using the word philia, "Yes, Lord, you know I have affection for you. I love you like a brother." Jesus doesn't settle for quick, superficial answers. He has a way of getting to the heart of the matter. Peter had to face his true feelings and his real motivations when Jesus confronted him. Billy Graham's daughter Anne says that her mother Ruth taught her to put her own name in the scripture so that it made it personal. For example, here we might be encouraged to put our name in the place of Peter's when Jesus asked the question, "Dan, do you truly love me? Dan, do you really love me? Dan, are you even my friend?" Many people think that Jesus asked Peter, "Do you love me?" three times to counter the three times that Peter denied his Lord. Actually, totally denounced it, disowned it. Not because Jesus had not already forgiven him, but as a way of canceling out the denials and restoring Peter to his place of leadership among the disciples. It's ironic that this is the man who at one time asked Jesus, "How many times do we have to forgive? Would 7 be enough?" And now, he stands in great need of the assurance that he is indeed forgiven. In the movie, I Can Only Imagine, the main character, Bart, who as many of you know is the lead singer for the group called Mercy Me, he's having trouble forgiving his father, who had been abusive and cruel to him when he was younger. And his father asked him this pointed question: "If God can forgive everyone else, why can't he forgive me?" Which was another way of asking his son, "Why can't you forgive me?" Peter knew Jesus was a forgiving man, but perhaps Peter struggled with forgiving himself. I believe Jesus is also asking Peter, "Do you love me enough to die for me? Are you going to remain true to me this time? I'm entrusting the future of the church into your hands. Can I count on you?" In verse 18, Jesus goes on to say, "When you were younger, you dressed yourself and you went where you wanted. But when you are old, you will stretch out your hands and someone else will dress you and lead you where you do not want to go." In some ways, this could be said of us all. In our youth, we live so much carefree lives. But when we are older, we must rely on others to dress us, to help us get around, even make us take a shower. My father was upset when we had to place my mother's sister in a memory care facility. I think he was afraid this was going to happen to him too. And so I reminded him that one of the deciding factors had been that she refused to take a shower. After that, when I came to visit, my father would say, "I just took a shower." It's a true story. Now he doesn't have to worry about that because he and my mom have caregivers who give them their showers every other day at home. But surely, Jesus was referring to something more here. Verse 19 says, "Jesus said this to indicate the kind of death by which Peter would glorify God. And then he said to him, 'Follow me.'" Now when we hear that call, "Come follow me," we tend to think how very pleasant to walk and talk with Jesus. But in this case, I believe Jesus was saying, "Follow me in the way of the cross." Church tradition tells us that Peter did indeed die for his faith. When the Romans set out to crucify him, he insisted on being hung upside down on the cross. For he told them, "I am not worthy to die in the same way as my Lord." A number of years ago, I attended a Promise Keepers conference in Miami. Evangelist Joe White took on the role of Peter. And at one point, he held a live rooster as he told us the story of how he had denied the Lord 3 times before he got caught. And at the end of that conference, he hung upside down on the cross to show us how Peter had chosen to die. Needless to say, we were all blown away. We read in verse 20, Peter turned and saw the disciple whom Jesus loved was following him. Now here, the writer of the Gospel, John, is referring to himself. And so we know that he's giving us a first-hand eyewitness account. He even reminds us, this is the one who had leaned back against Jesus at the supper and had said, "Lord, who is going to betray you?" When Peter saw John, he asked, "Lord, what about him?" And how very human it is to compare ourselves to others, including what is being asked of us versus what is being asked of them. And Jesus answered, "If I want him to remain until I return, what is that to you? You must follow me." Like Peter, we may be uncertain about our future, even fearful. We are not promised tomorrow. But we are invited to follow Jesus in faithfulness and obedience until he comes again or calls us home. Jesus told his disciples if they loved him, they would obey his commands. And he has commanded us to love one another and to take the good news of God's redeeming love in Christ to all the world in word and deed. Jesus has given his all for us. We need to give our all to him and for his glory. Amen. Jesus asked of us what he asked of Peter: "Do you love me?" We love him because he first loved us and gave himself for us. Isaac Watts responded this way: "Were the whole realm of nature mine, that would be an offering far too small. Love so amazing, so divine, demands my soul, my life, my all." Let us pray. Lord Jesus, we love you. Give us grace to love you more. Lord Jesus, give us grace to love each other as you have loved us, and to forgive each other as you have forgiven us. Amen. Our hymn of dedication is "My Jesus, I Love You." It's number 172. We'll stand together as we sing. Presence of the Holy Spirit be with you now and forevermore.